God and the Holocaust, a commemoration concert. During 2,000 years of exile, Jews lived among strangers, but assumed that they were living in their own homelands. Poland, Russia, the Ukraine, Lithuania, Latvia, Romania, Hungary, the Carpathian Mountains, Bessarabia, the big cities, and the many Jewish shtetla, the little villages, that for over 1,000 years constituted the Jewish landscape and their faith in a Jewish God. When it came to the big cities, God's image was fading as the more secular Jews reduced their routines of daily worship. A popular question among the youth at the turn of the 20th century was, where was God? And where was social justice? And since there was no viable answer, they turned to communism, Bundism, Zionism, socialism, and even anarchism in their search for answers to the hardships and the persecutions that they endured. The Jews began to discover the great classic literary writers like Sholem Aleichem with his Tevye, the dairyman, the model of unquestionable devotion to his God, and Yitzchak Leibish Peretz, who used Hasidic folktales as a vehicle for rabbinic wisdom. But it is during and after the Holocaust that the dialogue with God began surfacing in earnest. Jewish writers and poets began to search for answers, both in literature and in music. For many, no matter the degree of suffering or hardship, their faith remained strong. Ani ma'amin, I believe with full faith in the coming of the Messiah. And in spite of the fact that he is delayed, I will still believe. Ani ma'amin, ani ma'amin, ani ma'amin. Bevias HaMashiach, ani ma'amin. Ve'af al pi she'yismameya, im kol zeh ani ma'amin. You see, the Holocaust, it touched all Jews equally, knowing full well that the murderers did not discriminate between the pious and the free thinkers, the red flags and the holy scrolls, the rich and the poor, the scholars and the ignorant. As the Yiddish writer Avrum Lev points out in his ode, Down Below, he writes, a town of Jews is buried, both Hasidim and opponents. Saintly rabbis, cobblers, tailors, Zionists and communists, older folk and little children, for the slaughterers, all were equal. A segment of the religious community never abandoned their faith in God. Indeed, they saw deep meaning in their suffering and even greater glory in their dying. The Jews of the little West Galician shtetl of Grodzisk sincerely believed that pious and God-fearing Jews must come to heaven in one piece. Beards and their payas, their sidelocks, included, in spite of the order proclaiming that Jews had to cut off and shave their beards and their sidelocks. So in order to survive, the Jews reluctantly shaved their own beards and their payas, and they sewed them into their pockets with the intention of coming to heaven in one piece. It was far from their wildest imagination that they would be stripped of all of their clothing before they were sent to the gas chambers. The rabbi of Grodzisk, Rabbi Israel Shapiro, was brought to the Treblinka concentration camp together with a full transport of Jews. The Rebbe decided to hold a sermon at the gates of the crematorium. Listen, brothers and sisters, children of the Jewish people, we must not question the workings of our Creator. If it has fallen upon us to be the victims of the Messiah's coming and thereby burn in the flames, we are to declare ourselves fortunate. We are to be happy that our ashes will purify the entire people of Israel. Don't despair, but be joyous. And just like Rabbi Akiva in his time, you can die with the cry, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Echad, on your lips. The closeness that was felt by these Jews to their God was boundless. They trusted him with their children, abided by his laws. For no matter how the Almighty drives his flock from him, discards and punishes them, he is their stronghold and their salvation, always. In the words of the Yiddish poet Stenzel, if you cut down the tree, the root in the earth will remain, and if you tear out the roots, the seeds will spring up again. Oifen prepitschik brennt a feierl un in stub is a heis un der Rebbe lernt kleine Kinder lach dem alle verbeis. In the fireplace a fire is burning and the house is warm. And the rabbi, the Rebbe, is teaching young children the Aleph Beis, the Yiddish alphabet. Zeit she kinder lach, gedenk she tayere, vos ihr lernte do. Sag she noch amol, und tage noch amol, Komets Alepho. You see, my children, remember, dear ones, what you study here. Say it one more time, and then repeat it once again. Komets Aleph makes the sound O.
Azir vet kinderlach elter werden, vet ihr allein Farestein, wie viel in die Oisjes liegt mit Reden, ohne wie viel gewähnt.
When you, my children, when you get older, you will understand for yourselves how many tears are in those letters of the alphabet. And how much sorrow. After the Holocaust, European Jewish life and the shtetl became both a holy shrine and a symbol of suffering and victimhood, of education and faith and memories. Memories of a little shtetl called Bells. Bells, mein shtetl bells, meine heimale vichob, meine kinder sheyom farbach, sein dir amol gewen in a bell. Mein steht alle Bells. In Uremen stieb alle, mit alle Kinderlach, dort gelach. O jeden Schabbes pfleg ich, laufen dort mit, die Kinder lacht gleich. Sie sitzen unter dem grünen Bäumale, leben bei dem Tag. Bells, mein steht alle Bells. Meine Heimale, wie ich hab gehad, die schöne Chaloimes Asa. Bells. My little town, Bells. My little home, where I got to spend all of my childhood years. Did you ever see Bells? My little town, my little shtetl, Bells. In my poor little village, where all the children used to laugh and run around together. Every Sabbath, all the children would run together and we would sit under this little green tree. We had such a good time there, right near the river. Bells. My little town, my little shtetl, Bells. My home, where I had so many beautiful, beautiful dreams. Bells, mein shtetl, Bells. Mein Heimale, wie ich hab meine Kinder schon verbracht. Sein Tier am Morgen in der Bells. Meine steht alle Bells. In Uremen stieb alle mit alle Kinderlach dort gelacht. Oi, jeden Schabbes pfleg ich laufen dort
mit die Kinderlach gleich. Zu sitzen unter dem grünen Baum allein, leben bei dem Teichbell. Mein steht alle Bell, mein Heimale, wie ich hab gehabt die schöne Chaloime.
The brilliant Yiddish writer Chaim Grade wrote an essay entitled Mein Vikuach mit Herr Schrazeiner, My Quarrel with Herr Schrazeiner. It is considered one of the most articulate of all post-Holocaust discussions of faith and a classic work on the level of Shakespeare's Hamlet. Chaim and Hersch are two friends who grew up in the Orthodox world in Europe, and they were separated in the concentration camp. They both survived the war unbeknown to the other, and they meet years later by chance in a park. One is now a rabbi, while the other has become a atheist secular writer. During their extensive dialogue, Chaim demands to know, do you still believe in this merciless world? A miracle happened to you, Reb Hersch. You survived. But what about the rest? How can you still believe? But Herr Schrazeiner is adamant. Of course I believe. Without any doubt, I see God everywhere, in everything, at every moment, my personal providence. I couldn't remain on earth for 1 minute without the thought of God. How could I stand it without him in this murderous world? At which point Chaim cries out in despair. But I refuse to say that his judgment is right. Perhaps, Reb Hirsch, you are thinking of a man who believes that the Almighty is to be found only in the pleasant places of this world. You know the rule, replies Hirsch. Just as man must make a blessing over the good, so must he make a blessing over evil. Chaim interrupts. What do you want, Reb Hirsch? Shall I see the greatness of God in the thought that only he could have caused such a catastrophe and not man? The Psalms you recited on your bed in the concentration camp, see the greatness of God in the fact that the sun comes out every day. But you see miracles in catastrophe? Without a doubt, Herr Schrazeiner answered calmly. But a quick reply from Chaim baffles Hersch. You must ask God the old question about the righteous man who fares ill and the evil man who fares well. Only multiply it by 1.5 million murdered children. The fact that you know in advance that there will be no explanation from heaven does not relieve you of the responsibility of asking, Reb Hersch. As for us, even if we were devils, we could not have sinned enough for such a punishment in the millions. Papirosen, cigarettes. It's a Yiddish song that tells the story of a young Jewish boy who is selling cigarettes to survive on the street. He depicts his tragic fate. Having lost their parents, his younger sister has died, and eventually he loses hope himself. The night is cold and all around it's dark. A little boy stands there, he looks around with only a wall to protect him from the rain. In his hand is a little tray, and his eyes are beckoning to everyone who goes by. He's crying, "I no longer have the strength left to walk around the streets. I'm hungry, disheveled, and wet from the rain. From the day's beginning till its very end, no one wants to do business with me. They all laugh and make fun of me. Please come buy some cigarettes. They're dry. The rain did not get to them. Please buy them and have pity on me. Save me from hunger. Please come and buy some matches, and you'll help a poor orphan like me. Forgive me. Forgive me for shouting and for rambling on. But nobody is buying anything from me. Please help me. Otherwise, I will perish like a dog in the street. Buy my cigarettes." A kalte Nacht, a Nebel dicke, finster umetum, steht a Jingale vertreuert und guckt sich herum. Fin Regen schützt ihm nur a Wand, a Koschekul halt in Hand. In seine Augen beten jeden Sturm. Ich hab schon nicht kein Keuch mehr, herum zu gehen im Gas. Hungerig und abgerissen von dem Regen nass. Ich schlepp herum sich von Beginnen, keiner gibt nichts zu verdienen. Alle lachen, machen von mir Spaß. Kupitsche, Käufche, Käufche, Papyrussen. Trockene von Regen, nicht vergossen. Käufche billig, Benemones. Käuft und hat auf mir Rachmones. Rette net von Hunger, mich hat zehn. Kupitsche, Käufche, Schweber lachen, ticken. Der mit wird ihr Ayosmo, der quicken. Umsiehst mein Schreien und mein Läufen, keiner will bei mir nicht käufen. Ois gehen will ich musen wie a Hund. Den Regen nicht vergossen. Käuft sie billig, Benemones, käuft und hat euch mir Achmones. Ratte wird von Hunger, mich hat zehn. Kupit je, käuft je, Schweberlach, Antiken. Der mit wird ihr Ayosemur, der Quicken.
Und es ist mein Schreien und mein Läufen, keiner will bei mir nicht kaufen. Euch gehen will ich müssen, wie ein Hund.
One of the many protesters against God after the Holocaust tells in his diary the story of the Jews who emerged from hiding, and they started shouting at God, "Yidden, Jews, collect large stones and throw them up to heaven. Why has God picked on us for this torment? Give me rocks to throw at him in defiance." The Torah speaks of God's mercy. There was none. The Torah speaks of divine justice. Where was it? The Torah speaks of faith. But I have serious doubts. The Torah speaks of man being created in the image of God. But men are beastly devils, diabolical fiends and evil beings. Does this not mean that God himself is like this? Among the few Yiddish poets who survived, it is only Katzetnik, which was the pen name for Yechiel Denur, a victim of the Holocaust. He was a witness after the war at the Nuremberg trials. He is very well known for saying the following. He said, "What do we need a God for, if not to deter the wholesale slaughter of the innocent? I do not care for any of the philosophical and pious reasons and contrived explanations of the rabbis, which are bromides and cliches. There is and can never be any acceptable excuse for God."
Es brennt, o Brüderlach, es brennt. Oi, unser Ohr im Städtel, nebach brennt. Beise Winden mit ihr Gosen, reißen, brechen und zerblosen. Starker noch die wilde Flammen, als herum schon brennt. Und ihr steht und guckt aus euch sich mit verlegte Händ. Und ihr steht und guckt aus euch sich, wie unser Städtel brennt.
On fire, brothers. It's on fire. Our poor little village is on fire. Angry winds are roaring, blowing, tearing, breaking, and destroying, stronger still. The flames are growing. Everything is on fire. And you helplessly are watching as the flames go higher. And you helplessly are watching. Our town is on fire. Yaakov Gladstein was one of our most prolific poets and essayists. He sees the contract that was made on Mount Sinai reduced to ashes. He writes, God has not kept his word. He abandoned his people in their darkest hour, and hence the contract is dissolved. We received the Torah at Mount Sinai, but in Lublin, we gave it back. The dead cannot praise God. The Torah was given to the living. Another one of our great female Yiddish poets, Kadya Molodovsky, was born in Russia in 1894. Having emigrated to New York in the early 1900s, she was highly influenced by the greatest Jewish tragedy of the 20th century. And she wrote her own personal plea to God, a poem called El Chanon, Merciful God. She writes, Merciful God, choose another people for the time being. We are tired of dying. We have no more prayers left. Choose another people for the time being. We have run out of blood to be the victims. Oh, and one more favor grant us, oh merciful God of ours. Take back the divine glory of our genius. And so, the eternal flirtation with the glitter of the outside world came to an end in Yiddish literature. For no matter how narrow and confining Judaism may have seemed, the outside world was populated by wretched beings posing as humans, but acting like beasts. Aaron Zeitlin, the great intellectual, philosopher, and Yiddish poet, considers the beast innocent compared to the actions of men. He writes, tell me not that man is beast. Compared to man, the beast is an angel. Does a beast build crematorium? Does a beast throw little children into it? Tell me not that man is beast. Together with the famed Yiddish songwriter Sholem Secunda, they wrote this song, Donna, Donna, which became an international hit in spite of the fact that it's all about a little calf being led to the slaughter. On a wagon bound for the market, there's a calf with a mournful eye. High above him, there's a swallow winging swiftly through the sky. How the winds are laughing. They laugh with all their might. Laugh and laugh the whole day through and half the summer's night. Stop complaining, said the farmer. Who told you a calf to be? Why don't you have wings to fly with, like the swallow, so proud and free? Calves are easily bound and slaughtered, and they never know the reason why. But whoever treasures freedom like the swallow has learned to fly. Lacht der Wind in Korden, lacht und lacht und lacht er ob Atoga ganzen mit a halber Nacht. Donna, 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 Donna. Auf ne Fiedel liegt das Kälbel, liegt gebunden mit a Strick. Hoch in den Himmel flieht das Schwälbel, freut sich, dreht sich hin und zurück. Lacht der Wind in den Korden, lacht und lacht und lacht, lacht er ob a Toga ganzen und a halber Nacht. Donna, 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 Donna. See the reconciliation between the Jews and God is not an easy task in Yiddish literature. It is made possible by the realization that God must have equally suffered as his people did. He must have shared their destiny and their torture. As the Yiddish poet Alni writes in his poem, Time of the Swastika, he writes, the world is a prison behind bars. If it isn't God weeping, then on his robe, like on the divine presence, shines a yellow patch. Being on such intimate terms with God, whether in complete submission, partial acceptance, or even denial, the Jews have survived and thrived. Being Jewish demands keeping our historical obligations, knowing the religious foundations, the international consciousness, the political awareness, and our cultural expressions. Yiddish literature continues to reflect the continuation of the spiritual independence of the ageless Jewish community, with the Almighty leading the way. And although the loss was so heavy, the rewards of our survival and our ability to thrive in the face of adversity allow our dialogue to go on forever. So we bring our concert to a close with one of the most important songs of the Holocaust experience, the Partisaner Lied, the partisan song. Inspired by the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, it became the anthem of those who survived to say never again. Written by Hirsch Glick in 1943, this song expresses the optimism and the faith that no matter how bad things may get, we have each other, and there is always hope for tomorrow. Never, never say that you are going down your last road. Although the skies are lead and they cover the blue days, our promised hour will soon come. Our marching steps will ring out. We are here. From green lands of palm trees to lands with white snow mountains, we come with our pain. We come with our woe. And from wherever a spurt of our blood should fall, there will sprout our strength and our courage. Today the morning sun will accompany us, and our enemies will fade away with the yesterday. But if the sun waits to rise, like an anthem, this song will go from generation to generation. Because this song is written with blood and not with ink. It's not a tune sung by birds in the wild. This song was sung by people amidst the collapsing walls with pistols in their hands. So never, never say that this is your last road. Although the lead-filled skies are covering all of our blue days, our promised hour will soon come. Our marching steps will ring out. We are here. Our promised hour will soon come. And our marching steps will ring out. Indeed. We are here. Never again. Never forget. Zognit kein molas du gehst dem letzten Weg. Chotsch himlen bleine verstellen bläuete. Weil kommen wird noch unser ausgebänkte Show. Es wird apoikton, unser Trott, wir seinen do. Weil kommen wird noch unser Reus gebänkte Show. Es wird apoikton, unser Trott, wir seinen do. Von grünem Palmenland bis Land von weißem Schnee. Wir kommen on mit unser Pein, mit unser Weh. Und wo gefallen ist ein Sprott von unser Blut. Sprotzen wird dort unser Bure, unser Mut. Und wo gefallen ist ein Sprott von unser Blut. Sprotzen wird dort unser Gwure, unser Mut. Das Lied geschrieben ist mit Blut und nicht mit Blei. Es ist nicht kein Liedl von a Vogel läuft der frei. Das hat a Volk zwischen Fallen dick gewähnt. Das Lied gesungen mit ner Ganes in die Hand. Das hat a Volk zwischen Fallen dick gewähnt.
das Lied gesungen mit der Ganes in die Hand. Du sag nicht kein Mal, als du gehst dem letzten Weg. Gott Himmeln bleiene, verstellen bläue Tag. Komm in der Wett noch unser ausgebänkter Schock. Es wird abheugt und unser Trott, wir seinen da. Weil kommen wird noch unser ausgebänkte Schock. Es wird abheugt und unser Trott, wir seinen da.
Thank you. Never again. Never forget. Thank you.